Good morning, everybody. Is the voice okay? Are you able to hear and the video and the voice? Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. So let's get started. We were in the last class looking at the control hazards and how they have been solved. Because this initially appeared to be a very difficult problem. There are two possible solutions to control hazard. One type of solution is software solution. We'll look at this, and also the hardware solutions. We'll also look at this. These solutions were used, and as I was saying, that now the solution is a predictor based solution. In the software solution, one simple solution is that the compiler can, after the control statement, that is a branch and jump statement, it may insert no op. In the instruction set architecture, we were mentioning that there is one special instruction, no op, which basically achieves nothing. So after every control statement, like jump and branch statements, for the simple MIPS processor that we are discussing, we need two no ops. The other and a better approach in software is to just restructure the code a little bit. After the branch statement, bring some statements from the previous or latter part, which will not affect the other execution. We'll see this. We'll look at the delayed branch today. And then the hardware solutions. The hardware solutions is, can we reduce the branch delay? Another is to stall until the branch direction is known. And the third one, which has become extremely popular, is the predictor based. We have a simple hardware which guesses the path of the execution. And over the years, it's become sophisticated and almost 100% accuracy. We are able to predict the simple ones known as the static branch predictor. They just look at the instruction type and predict. The dynamic branch prediction, these maintain execution history of the instruction and based on that predict. But in this prediction based hazard resolution, you must be prepared to undo any mistakes, like the branch outcome was different, the instruction which should not have been executed or started to execute, and we will be able to undo that. And fortunately, in the MIPS pipeline, simple MIPS pipeline, just look at here, that the branch outcome will be known at the end of the third stage, the ALU stage, because branch equal to and so on are resolved at the end of the third stage. And therefore, the next two instructions that we cannot fetch them based on the branch outcome, because we know the outcome only on the third stage. Only the fourth instruction we can fetch based on whether the branch is taken or not taken. But fortunately, these two instructions have just fetch and decode at that stage. So the registers have not been updated, memory has not been written, and so on. But if we look at a deep pipeline, By the time the branch outcome is known, it may be possible that some instruction has updated the register, overwritten the register with new result, or updated the memory, and then it will be very difficult to undo. So that is one thing we need to remember, that even in the prediction based approach, if the pipeline is very long, we have to be extra careful that if by chance the prediction is wrong, we need to undo all the instructions that have got executed by mistake. We should be able to do that, and for that they should not have updated any register or memory, otherwise it would not be possible to undo. Now let's analyze little bit these branch hazards. The branch equal to instruction, that's the branch instruction, and whether the branch equal to the outcome will be known at the end of the ALU, third stage. And then there is a load word in the next instruction, there is another instruction, so on. Now, for the load word instruction, which is the immediate successor of branch equal to, definitely we cannot use the result of the branch outcome. The branch outcome is known too late. By that time, load word would have been fetched. And even the next instruction, it would have been fetched. So the load word would have been in the register decode stage, the instruction decode operand fetch, that is the stage. In the instruction 3, it would have been fetched, but the instruction 4, we would be just okay. We will be able to use the outcome of the branch condition checking. So that possibly we can get the correct instruction based on the branch outcome. If the branch condition is true, we'll have to fetch from the target. Otherwise, the branch condition is false, we just get the succeeding instructions. Now, for the fourth instruction, we are okay. We can just use the computation of the branch outcome and fetch the right instruction. But these two instructions, add and subtract, if we fetch that, then we might have to flush the pipeline. So flush means we need to make those instruction fetched and the register decode results vanish. Only the load word instruction that we can use. So two instruction we need to flush in hardware. Another way is to have two stalls. This is easier than flushing. We can just once a branch instruction is fetched, we can just stall the subsequent two instructions. But for the MIPS pipeline, we said that two instructions we need to stall. So the penalty after a branch is that two instructions we cannot execute, but wait. But can we reduce the stall cycles? Okay, let's analyze the pipeline data path and see if that is possible. Look at the pipeline data path. The branch outcome is known at the end of the ALU stage. And that's the main reason that we are getting delayed, because this order and the shift left, we can as well bring them to the previous stage. It's not a problem. because sine x 10, after sine x 10, we should be able to shift left and add. That we can do here in the second stage. But this adder, which is checking the branch condition, that would require us to wait for the ALU. But if we can somehow afford another ALU in the second stage, then we can reduce the branch delay by 1 cycle. And that's what exactly we'll do. We will move the comparator to the previous stage, and that will reduce the branch delay to 1 cycle. So that's what we have done here. What we have done is brought back this adder, the multiplexer, from the previous stage to this stage, and also we have this hardware which can check these registers for equal to, greater than, equal to, the conditional check it can do. So this is the extra hardware we need. We need a simplified ALU which can do the logical operations. And then if we have this extra hardware, the branch delay will be 1 cycle. I hope everybody is okay with it. Now the flush pipeline, that is a possibility. Once the branch outcome is found to be branch taken, we need to flush the instructions which have been fetched. But for MIPS pipeline, 2 instructions need to be fetched if the branch is taken. But for longer pipeline, maybe 10 or 15 instructions need to be flushed. The other approach is branch prediction, which is the much more successful, and we'll focus on this. But as I mentioned, that this is a large topic. Branch prediction would need us 7 or 8 classes. It's a sophisticated predictors are available. And of course, the ones that are used in industry, those are proprietary. They don't even give any hint about how they have designed the predictor. But then even the ones which are available in the book and literature, those are also quite sophisticated, can easily achieve more than 99% branch prediction success rate. But we will restrict us to only simple predictor. Today we will try to complete the chapter 4 of the book, and that includes the predictors and so on. And from next class onwards, we'll start the memory, because that's also a large topic we are not yet discussed. And number of classes now is very less, because Monday happens to be a holiday, and Thursday we'll have the next class, and we'll have a quiz also. And one more scheme is the delayed branch, which is a software approach. Here we don't change hardware anything. The same hardware, we don't take care of the control hazard at all. But then in the 2 slots, in the 2 instructions following a branch, the compiler rearranges the instruction so that useful work gets done without really causing a hazard. So the misprediction, look at this, this is a 20-stage pipeline. Okay, more than 20 actually. So there are more stages, but the branch outcome is resolved at 20 stages. And by the time the branch outcome is resolved, several other instructions have got fetched. And this is a single issue. There are also superscalar architecture, which is not, we're not going to discuss in this course. We replicate the pipeline, and then there will be many more instructions to be flushed. So if we have a misprediction, we know the end of the branch resolve stage. then all these instructions which have started executing for number of pipeline cycles, they will have to be flushed. So all these, once the mispredict is done, all these instructions need to be flushed out and refetched at the correct instruction. So this is the correct path instruction. All these we need to flush out. Now first, let's look at the software solution, which is the delayed branch. Here, no hardware support is necessary. It is as if in the hardware we don't bother about control hazard. And it is the compiler who will take care that the hazard does not occur. How does it do? Let's look at it. The idea is very simple. For the MIPS pipeline, we will have two delay slots. And this is some other pipeline for simplicity was shown. There is a single delay slot. So that means that whenever there is a branch instruction, the next instruction is doubtful. The next instruction, if we take the PC plus 4, then if we execute that and the branch outcome turns out to be true, branch is taken, then we need, that would be a wrong instruction. So we don't really execute the next instruction. What we do is in the delay slot, we put some instruction, we rearrange the code, and some instruction before the branch, you just transfer it to the delay slot. And maybe some instruction much below, which will anyway get executed. See, the instruction before the branch, they will anyway be executed. And therefore, we will put in the delay slot here. So by the time those instructions are executed, we know the outcome of the branch and the correct instruction can be fetched. So in the delay slot, we put an instruction which will get executed no matter what the outcome is, and the safe instructions are above the branch instruction, those which are preceding sequentially the branch instruction, they would have anyway got executed. We can put them here in the delay slot. And also we'll see that some instruction after the branch instruction, we can put them. And the work is compiler, will be done by the compiler. And let's see what is required. Now let's say we have a processor which has n number of delay slots. So only at the end of the n instruction, the outcome of the branch will be known and the branch target can be fetched. Now it is the duty of the compiler to somehow fill instructions which will anyway get executed. And for the MIPS pipeline, the delay slot is 2. Now let's look at this, that for this code, let's say if R2 equal to 0, then jump to the target. And let's say there is only one delay slot for some processor. It's not the MIPS processor. Some processor, single delay slot. So what we can do is look at this double add, DADD instruction before the branch. So this will anyway get executed by the time. So can we transfer this here to the delay slot? Okay, we have transferred it here. So first the branch condition instruction executes, and then the DADD, and by the time the DADD completes, the branch outcome is known. This is not the MIPS processor, some other processor for simplicity. So if the compiler can do this, then the branch hazard is resolved. It's achieved the solution in software. But is there a catch? Otherwise, why do we have to use the predictor and so on? Is there a catch? So can anybody answer that this can only have a limited success? What's the reason? Very limited success through delayed branch. Yes, sir, please.
Data dependency.
So can you sorry, what's your name?
Shivans.
Okay, but then can somebody this does not appear to be a straight answer. Data dependency, how does it affect? It's not clear. Can somebody answer this question?
Sir, if there is a data dependency between the branch instruction and some previous instruction.
Okay, yes. So if there is, if the branch instruction is affected by the result produced by the previous instruction, we cannot bring. Okay, yes. I think that's more acceptable. So Ravi, thank you. So we cannot move. Many times we will not find enough number of instructions to move after the branch in the to fill the delay slot. Now, can we take some instruction after the branch? So here we have put the odd instruction and the double odd instruction, and instead of stalling, we have been able to execute this instruction, so the branch hazard has vanished. And by the time this instruction completes, we are able to know the branch outcome and we can execute. So there is some problem with some network issue. Let me just resolve that. Are you able to hear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So fine. So even though the slide is giving some problem, it's not loading. But then let me tell that can we take some instruction after the branch? Like there are two paths actually. One is the So we can not only the preceding instruction, we can even take instruction much before if they somehow don't affect the instruction that are after this. The result does not affect. So this is some R4 and not used after that between the branch. That also we can bring. But this is the one we have brought here. R4 register is not used in between, so we have been able to put R4 in the branch delay slot. But can we put instruction from the fall throw path? So the one that is there sequentially after BEQZ, can that be in the delay slot? Yes, it can be in the delay slot if it does not affect the R7 register is not used in the taken path. This is the not taken path. See the branch equal to zero, the sequentially succeeding instructions. This is the not taken path. So if we put an instruction in the delay slot from the taken, not taken path, that is the sequentially succeeding one, then if R7 is not used in the taken path, then we can do it. It will compute it. And by chance, if it is not taken, this will be a useful thing. Otherwise, in any case, it does not affect the taken path. So only the result is useful only when the branch is not taken. And the result will not be used. If the branch is taken, but then it does not affect the taken path result. So this we can do, the compiler can analyze. If does not find any instruction in the instruction preceding the BEQZ, then it can try to find instructions in the fall through path and see if any of these, the result produced, does not affect the target path, then it can put in the delay slot. So here, in this example, just look at here that the BEQZ, before that, there are two instructions, but both of them are affecting R1. So we cannot put those instructions in the delay slot. Both load and desub, we cannot put in the delay slot. But if R1 is not equal to 0, so that is the target path. Sorry, R1 equal to 0 is the target path, and this is the fall through path, R1 is not equal to 0. Now, can we put some instruction here? Assuming that only these are the instructions there, then no further instruction after DADD. Can we put, okay, this is the target path and this is the fall through path. So can we put OR? Yes, we can put OR because R4 is not used here. But can we put DADD? No, because DADD uses R4 and R4 should have been computed by OR. So we can put only OR instruction. But what about DADD? This target path instruction, double add unsigned R7, R4, R8, R9. Yes, we can also put this because R7 is not used in the fall through path. So we might move instructions from the fall through path or the target path if they don't affect the results computation in the other path, but then the usefulness of this is conditional on whether the branch is taken or not taken. Sometimes this will computation will be wasted. But if it is before the branch, then the result is definitely going to be useful. And therefore, when restructuring the code, we should be able to first look at the instructions before the branch and then look at the fall through or the target path to find instruction. And sometimes it may happen that we find no instruction and the branch delay slot, we have to put no op instruction. So given a simple code, should be able to restructure. Now let's take some examples, one or two simple examples. But then this is the summary of the delayed branch approach, where the compiler can help to solve the control hazards without any modification to the hardware. So here we need to fill the delay slot for every processor, pipeline processor. There will be a number of delay slot that we know for MIPS it is 2. And we first look at before the branch, try to fill the delay path, sorry, delay slot. Otherwise we look at the target path or the fall through path and then try to fill the delay slot. Typical experience is that for a simple processor like MIPS, 60% of the delay slots are filled. For deeper pipelines, it will be much less because many more delay slots have to be filled. Here only 2, so we are able to fill 60%, and 80% of the instruction executed are useful computation. So that means roughly 50% of the slots are usefully filled. Now, for delayed, for deeper pipeline, the result will be much less encouraging because we will not be able to fill the delay slot. So this approach might be okay for simple processors like pipeline, like MIPS simple five-stage pipeline. But for modern processors, this will be hardly effective. Maybe if we use this, maybe give some 5% or something performance improvement. Now let's do a simple problem here. Now this is the code for a simple five-stage MIPS pipeline. Not simple five-stage MIPS pipeline. Here we have an extra order to reduce the branch delay in the five-stage pipeline so that the number of delay slot required is one. We had seen that by using the extra order, we can reduce the delay slot by one. Now this is the code. So how do we restructure this code using the delayed branch approach? So can anyone say which instruction we can bring after the J? J is the branch instruction here. So can we bring any instruction from before the branch? Can we bring load word one? No, it is used in the ARD. Can we bring the ARD instruction? Yeah, it is unconditional branch, so we can bring the ARD instruction. So just brought the ARD instruction. If we didn't find any instruction, we'd have to put the no op instruction here. But fortunately, we found the ARD instruction here. So the compiler will transfer that instruction from before the branch to after the branch, and the control hazard vanishes. Now there is another problem here. So this is the this is the simple code here. Now how will the compiler can restructure this code to handle control hazard when no hardware support is available? It's a simple MIPS processor. So two slots, two delay slots. So here.
We can bring that branch instruction after sub instruction.
Okay. So we can bring the sub instruction, right? No, but BNEZ uses
that. BNEZ, we have to bring BNEZ instruction after the sub instruction.
See, we are not moving the BNEZ, we are moving the other instruction after the BNEZ. So those are the delay slots. So can we bring add UI after the BNEZ?
Yes, sir. Add UI and SW instruction after the BNEZ instruction.
So SWR2, is it? Okay. So yes, sir. Let's look that. Okay, very good. So Cyprem, very good. So yes, the compiler will do that. And here we are successfully able to fill the branch delay slot. We can next quiz, we'll just give you a small code and ask you to find which instructions can be filled for the MIPS pipeline and what will be the penalty if it cannot be filled and so on. Simple problem, just to check whether you have understood, just one simple problem. Now let's look at the branch prediction approach. The branch prediction is necessary for the modern pipeline because the pipeline has become deep. For Core 2 Duo, it is 14 stages. For Intel Core i7, which we are using in our laptop and desktops, 12 stages. And for some time, the predecessor of i7, the Pentium processor, had 31 stages. For some reason, the number of stages has reduced, but that's a discussion for a higher level course. We will not discuss why the stages reduced, but then again, the stages are now increasing. It's now 12 stages, but for 12 stages, we cannot use the stall. That will be too much of penalty on the performance, and also we cannot use the delayed branch because finding so many instructions will be difficult. Most of the delay slots will become unused. Now let's try to analyze the branches. The branches that we have been discussing are the direct branches, where the branch address is there as part of the instruction. Like if branch equal to etc. etc. branch not equal to, and jump and link, procedure call, and go to, these are the addresses, they are part of the instruction. But then we have indirect branches where the branch address is stored in a register, like a return. So these are two types of branches we need to handle. We'll see that the indirect branches are very straightforward. These are the direct branches we need to be concerned. And the branches can be unconditional or conditional, like jump, subroutine call, and return from subroutine, that we call as unconditional. And the conditional are branch equal to 0, etc., not equal to 0. Now, for the unconditional branches, if we there is nothing to resolve, basically the no branch condition is there, so at the ID stage, once the instruction is known to be unconditional branch, we know that the branch will jump to the target 100%. It will not fall through because it is a jump, unconditional jump, call subroutine, etc. But there is a problem, there is a catch here. The catch is that even though we know that these are unconditional branches and they will go on the target path, but then what is the target address? That is not known. So that is a problem we need to address, that even though branch outcome is known, but the target is not known. Now, roughly, there are two main types of predictors. One is the static predictors, and the other is dynamic predictors. The static predictor, as the name says, we just predict based on the instruction type. Very simple predictor, nothing is required almost here. We just have a set of rules that for this kind of instruction, it is taken or not taken. Whereas a dynamic predictor are the sophisticated predictors where we maintain the execution history of the branch instructions, and based on that we predict. So for static, we have simple rules like we'll say that it will never be taken, it will always fall through. And by chance, if it is taken, we have to flush. Or we might have a simple rule, a static predictor rule, is that always taken. Another rule is if the there is a backward jump, then it will be taken, but forward is not taken. The main reason why this is successful, backward taken and forward not taken, among all the three approaches of the static predictor, is that the loops are typically backward branches, jump to the beginning of the loop. So if you analyze a piece of assembly code, you'll find that whenever there is a backward branch, it's the loop basically. And therefore, all the backward branches are taken and forward not taken. So that is a strategy that possibly works better than these two static based approaches, but still the results are not very encouraging. The dynamic ones are use the execution history. And as I was saying that this can be very sophisticated, we will restrict our discussion to the simplest dynamic predictor, which is called as the one bit predictor. So here we maintain only one history. What the branch was doing last time? Was the branch last time taken or was it not taken? Based on that, we'll predict. The simplest dynamic predictor, we'll only in this course we'll discuss this. The two-bit predictor, correlating predictor, and so on, those we'll not discuss. Now let's be clear what we need to predict. Of course, we need to predict the branch direction. If it is unconditional branch, okay, we know the direction, but for other instruction, conditional branches, we need to predict the branch direction. But also, if the branch is taken, just predicting that it is taken does not help. Because we need to have the address to which it will jump. Otherwise, just predicting taken is no use. And this is the difficulty in the static predictors, that even if we predict that it is taken, by that time we don't know the address, and so the prediction is as good as useless. Now the static predictor works based on the instruction type, and the instruction type is known at the decode stage in the MIPS pipeline. And at the second stage, we will predict. So by the time we predict, one instruction may already be have to fetched. Because for MIPS, it is two instructions. And even if we predict in the second stage, still we are not doing very well. Because in any case, one instruction would have already been fetched. So that we might have to flush or something. But look at this dynamic prediction. Here, we just predict based on the instruction, that is the program counter. So at the instruction fetch stage, we are able to tell that what will be the next instruction. Which means that for every instruction, it says what is the next instruction, not only for the branch, because we are not checking the type of the instruction. We're just looking at the program counter and saying that what is the next program counter. Now, first, let's look at the simple static predictor. We'll assume that all are not taken, or not at all are taken. So there is nothing much to implement here. The predictor is very simple, needs very small hardware support, almost nothing. But for the dynamic predictor, we need to maintain the history of execution. We need storage in the processor. And modern processors have quite complicated, and they maintain number of branch last executions. And they are called as the profile-based prediction. Improves accuracy substantially, but there is overhead. We need to maintain a lot of history of the branches. Now for the static, the simplest one is branch not taken. We'll just keep on executing instruction as if the branch is not there. So if the branch is not taken, we have zero penalty. So for predict branch not taken, we basically don't need any hardware support. It is the processor as it is executing, excepting the overhead that will be required, possibly that we need to flush if the branch was found to be taken, the prediction is wrong. And 47% of the branches are not taken on the average. So for 47% of the instruction, our prediction will be right. We'll incur 0%, zero penalty. But for 53% of the instructions, we'll incur two cycle penalty because we will have to flush those instructions. But then the question is that why not use the branch taken rule? Why use the branch not taken? And see here, the Intel i486 actually used this predictor, the static predictor. This was sometimes in the 90s, the i486 processor was there, and that used this, I think 95 or whatever. I don't remember the exact year, but somewhere around that. The Intel i486 used the branch not taken approach. Then the question is that, see here only 47% of the branches can be predicted successfully. So why didn't they use the branch taken approach? They could have predicted branches taken. Can anybody answer this question? They went for the 47% success. Why not? They could have as well used the branch taken predictor. Simple static predictor. Can anybody answer this question?
Sir, for the branch taken case, one extra clock cycle is needed.
For what?
Extra branch not taken case.
Okay.
Proving that is more beneficial.
Okay, somewhere correct that still we need one cycle delay because we need to check the instruction type. Here we just keep on fetching instruction as it is. The problem is much more deeper than that. The problem is that the target is not available. So even if we predict taken, we cannot use that result. Target, we don't know, taken, okay, fine, but still we need to stall because the target will be computed much later. So that is after the ALU stage. So we need still two cycle delay. So as if the branch taken is not helping us at all. So there is zero use of the branch taken approach. But in any code, any typical code, average code, 53% of the branches are taken. Can anybody answer that why branch taken is much more than branch not taken? Anybody can use common sense and just make a guess.
Sir, code is written in such a way, sir, the programmer writes the code in such a way that the more like the case which is more like the probability of occurrence is more.
Not really. Programmer doesn't do that. Not that. Can anybody answer? Mainak, sorry, that's not the answer. Anybody else can answer?
Sir, loop.
Yeah. So who is this? Can you tell your name?
Sivan.
Okay, Sivans. So that is the reason. The loops. So they are the ones where the branches are taken. So in typical program, the loops iterate hundreds of times. And therefore, the branches in the loops are much more than the other branches. The if then else, branch equal to, etc. I mean, the other kind of if then else branches are much less compared to the loop. And typically they have computed 53%, but then for some program where we access large arrays and some etc., it can be much more than that. But branch taken approach is not helping us anything in the MIPS pipeline. So the branch address will be computed at the end of the EXE stage. If we So the address calculation is at the end of the ALU stage. In any case, we'll have to wait two cycles. So the branch taken approach does not help us. Now we can do simple exercise based on this. Just one or two I'll just do. One is that a simple MIPS pipeline. you just predicted, not taken. And 16% of the instructions are branches, 4% are unconditional branches, and we know that for unconditional branches, the penalty is 2 cycles because the target is not known. And 12% of the 16% are conditional branches, and 50% are taken. And for taken branches, we know that 2 cycle penalty. And 50% not taken is 0 cycle penalty. So can you quickly compute how much is the performance affected by the control hazard on this pipeline? And we are using a simple predict not taken approach, where basically we don't need much hardware excepting for the flossing pipeline when there is a prediction mistake. Okay, we will, the time is very less actually, otherwise we would have waited for you to complete. The answer is very simple. For the 4% unconditional branches, we have 2 cycle penalty. And for 50% of the 0.1 to 12% also, we have 2 cycle penalty. So overall, it is 1.2, if you compute this, instead of a CPI of 1, we have 1.2, so 20% performance hit. For static prediction, we predict at the instruction decode stage. And please answer this question, that what is the performance gain due to correct prediction, what is the penalty due to misprediction. For dynamic, we predict at the instruction fetch stage so that we can predict the next instruction based on the prediction, and what is the gain due to correct prediction and the penalty due to misprediction. Now the direction based prediction, here let's look at this code, add, load word, subtract and branch equal to. Now if you have to guess what is the outcome of branch equal to, what would you guess? Is it the next sequential instruction L2 or the branch target? So L1 is here. See, this is a backward branch. It's jumping to branch equal to L1, and L1 is backward. And we said that this is basically appears like a loop, and therefore we will mostly guess that it will be the odd instruction which will get executed. So whenever we have a branch backward, it is most of the time taken. And can we use this simple analysis that we take all backward branches, so these are all predicted to be taken, that is easily known, and the forward branches, they are not taken. So used in later processors in late 90s, Pentium Pro, etc., they use this approach, static predictor, backward taken, forward not taken. Now let's do this quiz. 20% branches, 60% are taken, 40% not taken. A static not taken predictor is used in the simple MIPS pipeline. What is the performance penalty? So again, we are short of time. I'll just have the solution here. We need to know that 2 cycle penalty for a misprediction, and then we can easily compute this. Please go through. Unfortunately, we are a bit short of time. And there is another quiz where we use a taken predictor for similar thing. So what is the penalty here? It is a taken predictor used in the simple MIPS pipeline. So can anybody answer? This requires no special computation here. Now, once we know that it is a taken predictor. So can anybody answer that what is the performance penalty for this case? 20% branches and we use a taken predictor. So taken predictor in MIPS is as good as useless. So we again incur two cycle penalty for 20% branches, even with the predictor or without predictor. So 20% into 0.2 is 0.4, so 1.4. So we are at the end of the class, we'll look at the one bit predictor on Monday, happens to be holiday on Thursday, and we'll have the quiz also on the Thursday, and I'll just give you a mail separately for that. And we'll complete the one bit predictor, maybe 10-15 minutes, and then we'll start with the memory, because the cache and the RAM, they are important part of the computer, and how they work, etc., this is very important. We will just spend the rest of this semester discussing memory. That's chapter 5. So chapter 4 will complete quickly in the next class, and we'll start with the chapter 5. We'll stop here. Thank you.